Hello and welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. This is Amethyst Lunatari, and this is an interactive Let's Play where you get to choose at the end of the video and vote on what step is to be taken in the next one, in the next video. So the choice was unanimous last time. We found a troll in a tower. As you move towards the tower entrance, a shadow falls across the doorway. The shape is stooped and hideous. It would seem this place is home to a troll. It has not yet noticed you. You watch the creature as it paces around inside the ruined tower. It appears to be ordering things, moving stone blocks from one point to another. Now, last episode, the choice was unanimous to approach the troll, so we will now do so. You march over, and the troll's eyes snap up to meet yours. Then he lumbers out into the daylight. Okay, I'm not going to immediately draw my sword. Casting a spell might be a good idea, but let's look him over. He stands at least a head taller than you, and his shoulders fill the exit. The troll roars and bangs his massive sword against a shield large enough to squash you with. He is a ferocious enemy of incredible strength. Okay, so I guess not a friendly troll after all. What kind of spells can we cast? Now, if this follows regular D&D rules, he'll be susceptible to fire, which that is not. That's actually hot. Fireball is hot. We don't have H. Alright. Force field does seem like a good idea, though. We do have lightning bolt, zap, teleportation to a random area, which may or may not be a good thing to do. Okay, I'm guessing M is... Oh. Quicksand requires sand, which we do not have. Cause depression. It's interesting, we haven't used that one yet. Cause stupidity. I don't know how intelligent trolls really are. Not much anyway. Not sure if it would make a difference. Talk all languages. Might be interesting to do. Of course, it looks like it just wants to attack me anyway. Right, the exploding pebbles. We have a lot of options here. Here. Let's try cause depression. I'm curious, partially because we've never used this spell before. You craft the spell and the sluggish troll slows down even more. He should be easier to fight now. I could still cast another spell. I was heading for Z here. No. I might just fight him. What if I cast it again? Of course, I'll waste a stamina spell. Who knows if it really stacks, you know? I keep hitting that one. Sharpened blade. Languages. Kind of curious about the dim, but that would take another stamina point. How about the exploding pebble? I have a few pebbles. Reaching up to the stars, you create the magic over one of your pebbles. The pebble explodes on the troll's nose. He stumbles back, allowing you to rush in. Okay, so maybe I can take advantage of this now. Not use quite all my strength, but a good cut. Alright. The troll slopes forward. Then, while still a sword's length away, he drops down into a sulky crouch behind his thick little shield. You raise your own sword, ready to meet him with a brutal attack and crash against his defenses. He begins screaming and shouting. I wonder if I had cast that speak all languages spell, if I would, we would understand what he was screaming and shouting. I'm gonna defend this round. Good idea. You drop into a defensive stance. The troll tries to wear you down, but you turn his blow aside. You adjust your grip and square your shoulders. His shield comes up. Should we attack now? He's gonna be kind of tough, isn't he? He stops to brush tears from his eyes, and you seize the moment to strike. Is this because he's depressed? Turning your sword, you punch with the hilt as he reels, you lash out with your blade. He reacts as best as he can, muster, ducking. You knock chips from his shield. The troll shifts his grip on his sword. Should we attack again? Good. Oh, nice. You keep up the pressure. You thrust, making swift progress across the dirt towards him. His own miserable blow is knocked away. The troll is stumbling, his wiry old muscles leaking green blood. Ugh. The troll shifts his clutch on his mean sword. Should I defend? Yeah. You drop back. As the troll swings with great force, you parry in a flash of sparks. He stamps back. Not doing too bad here. You spy an opening and go on the attack. You swipe him with your blade. He has no faith in his own attack and defends instead. The troll steps away quickly. Maybe I'll risk a side swipe here. Good. You batter at his blade. You lash out with your blade. He tries to cut you, but you have all the momentum of the fight. You catch the troll a slight nick. Blood trickles across the surface of his armor. He shifts from you fast. Again? Yeah, he doesn't seem too tough right now, does he? You are easily the better swordsmistress. Reaching down, you toss a handful of dirt into his eyes and cut him as he staggers. You cut across his stumpy blade. The troll moves out of reach. Here we go, we're just knocking him down with side swipes. The fight must be yours. You cut him as he tries to turn. He defends in a panic. The troll stamps at the ground and curses in an unknown tongue. The troll stamps back in swift strides. You keep up the pressure. You cut him as he tumbles over his feet. He tries to cut you, but you have all the momentum of the fight. You catch the troll a tiny cut. He steps away. One more side swipe. Side swiperama. Oh, he won that one. Ooh. Then he catches you off guard. You try a fast attack, keeping yourself as much covered as you can, while still cutting forwards, but the troll stabs faster than you. He shifts from you quickly. One more side swipe. There we go. He's still... yeah, I think we're gonna keep that, though. You seize the moment to strike. You cut him as he staggers. You swing, spinning around on the spot, and the last cut slices through the troll's neck. 4 stamina lost, decent dueling. Thank you, game. You get to your feet and gather your wits. The troll is quite dead. I'm gonna search his body, of course. You quickly search the troll's body, finding nothing but a charm around his neck, a goblin's tooth strung onto a string. Sweet, we can use that to summon a goblin. We might already have one. Let me look. We either have a goblin's tooth or a giant's tooth. I forget. Giants. Or back to the flashing again. I thought they fixed that. Yeah. I must have used my goblin's teeth, so let's take one. You tug the tooth away, snapping the string. The path continues in both directions and a tower is open to you. Yay! We can go down to the valley. Let's check out the tower. You step between the fallen blocks of the ruined tower. It stinks. Look around. You pause and look around the broken, shattered room. This was a fine building once. There are hints of carvings and decorations on the stonework, even though all of it has now tumbled away and the tower is open to the elements. Niches set into the walls once held idols and statues, and a curving spiral staircase once climbed upwards but is now broken halfway. Search the ruins. You search around the ruins and come across something black under a stone. It is a folded cloth. You pull it free. The cloth is thick and heavy, and has been neatly folded into a square. There is something bulky inside which you can feel through the cloth, but whatever it is not heavy. Oh, so the cloth is heavier. Unwrap it. Now shake it out, I might break it. You unwrap the cloth. In the center of it is a short length of knotted rope. You look at the knotted rope, but its purpose is unclear. It is too short to climb and too thick to tie to anything. Why did anyone wrap it up and leave it here? Open out the black cloth. You turn your attention to the cloth. It has two loose sleeves and a heavy hood. After a moment, you realize what it is. It is the habit of a monk, and a knotted rope is a belt. Look it over. It seems in one piece and full of moth holes. You could try it. Okay. Putting it on. You gather up the monk's concealing habit and quickly pull it on. What? You will now pass as a monk. Huh. Cool. I'm assuming I can use this disguise whenever I want to. Is it in inventory? Is my armor in inventory? Be regular items. Monk's habit worn. I guess we'll just keep it on. Can I wear it in combination with the blonde wig? That would be funny. I guess I'm just wearing it over my actual armor. What am I going to do with these ancient bronze coins and a fistful of gems? What am I going to do with this food I can't cook? Let's climb the stairs. You wind your way up the stairs to about halfway up the tower's height. The stairs end a few paces further on. They have been sheared off by the same force that removed the entire roof of the tower. Step to the edge. You step carefully to the broken edge of the stairs, two more steps, taking each one at a time in case the stone should give way under your weight. After three steps, you stop. The broken edge of the stairs is now one step away. Why am I doing this? Take another step. You take another step, and then another, still climbing. Looking back, the stairs behind you seem quite intact. Looking in front, there are only a couple before they fall to ruin. And with each step you take, it seems more steps appear. Well, we're definitely checking this out. We got some kind of magical staircase. You pace step by step up the tower, spiraling round and round until you finally reach a trapdoor in a non-existent roof. It's like we're going in back in time, like the beacons from the previous chapter. I'd feel silly hurrying back down. I'd always wonder what's behind this door. So let's push it open. You push the trapdoor open and step out onto the roof of the tower. It is a tower. It is one of these time-travel-type towers. The wind whistles past your head, ruffling your hair. You are standing high above the pass, atop a tower that was not here when you passed through the path below. I don't know, should I use this one? Supposedly I'm killing people whenever I use it somehow? A brass beacon of the kind you have seen before stands here. There is a faintest shimmer of magic in the air here. At first glance, the beacon seems quite intact, but there is no light shining from it now. You step away from the trapdoor and walk out across the roof. Wait, no, didn't mean to do that. The beacon. You move over to the eye of the beacon. A shimmering blue crystal is set at the end of it. Now, touching the crystal renews our stamina? Or puts us up to we can travel to other beacons? I forget. Restore stamina. You reach in to touch the crystal, wondering if you can activate the beacon. But though you touch it, nothing happens beyond a sense of healing wellness that floods your veins. The beacon seems unchanged as you step back. Too bad it didn't heal us to full. Turn the beacon. You try to turn the heavy beacon, but unlike the towers in the Backlands, this one appears firmly fixed, its eye pointing out towards Mampang and its central tower. You step away from the beacon. You hear a quiet cough from somewhere behind you. Who's there? You call, but there is no reply. The edge. And you hear another cough, and someone pushes you over the edge. You head over to the edge of the tower, just by the end of the large brass lantern. Look over the edge. Leaning over the edge, you have a surprise. The tower below is still not there. Looking down, you see nothing but ruin and rubble, and yet, under your feet, the planks are quite sound and solid. Look out across the land. You look out across the land towards a deep crater in the earth that is split like a bleeding sore by a black, hissing vent in the ground. No doubt this hellhole was the quarry used to build the citadel that lies beyond. Mampang itself dominates the skyline, enough to chill the hardest of hearts. At its top is a tower with a single high window, the Archmage's turret room. Looking back at the lantern, you are surprised to see that there is indeed a very faint light spilling from its end. It seems the beam is active, but it has been focused into an extremely narrow beam that reaches across empty space towards the citadel. You step back from the edge of the tower. Just then, a robed figure steps out from a shadowy spot behind the lantern. Ah, the coughing one. The figure. You're not a monk, are you? You approach the figure boldly. Greetings, it declares. And what are you doing here? I don't have an option to actually answer him, at least not right now. I'll just say greetings. The figure nods. You seem remarkably intact, it observes. Intact? Indeed. It is most curious, since the lower floors of this tower are home to more than one mind snake, and I would not expect any traveler to simply walk in. I saw no snakes. No, indeed, replies the creature. Mind snakes are hardly visible, but their sharp end is quite sharp, and usually quite hungry. Mind snakes. You don't suppose one of these mind snakes could be controlling my mind, do you? Thinking that, making us think that we're up here, but this is all some dream while it feasts on our brain? Are you not afraid of them yourself? I am terribly afraid of them, obviously. The creature strokes its sharp chin. All in all, this situation is most unexpected. Let me ask you a few questions. Indeed, the creature returns in some reply. Some surprise, sorry. I really want to know more about these beacons. I also want to know who he serves, but, I have seen beacons like this before. You tell the creature, "This is the last of the great beacons built across the backlands," the creature guarding the tower declares. "They are lenses, and like all lenses, they collect, focus, and deliver. Only they do not focus and deliver light." There was something strange about the creature's speech, as though the conversation was happening out of its proper order. Are we jumping around in time? They focus time. Indeed, that is correct. These beacons destroyed the backlands. Indeed they will, replies the watching creature calmly. Slowly they will remove the future from that place and deliver it to my master, the Archmage. He nods. Well, now we know who he serves. He desires immortality. It cannot be achieved, but extreme longevity is a close second. Why do you serve him? It is right that I should serve someone, the creature replies, as you do. When I entered this tower, it was ruined. Its future was stolen, right? You explain. The creature cocks its hooded head and considers that with some interest. Remarkable, it breathes. I sense the truth in your words, though I cannot understand them. Perhaps I should summon a snake up here to test your assertions. Oh, God. The creature nods to you. I must resume my calculations, he declares. You nod in return. If you survived your journey up my tower, no doubt you will survive the journey down. I talk to him some more by going over here. You go back to the beacon. The creature watches you with some suspicion. Look at the light. You peer along the length of the light beam. As it heads towards Mampang and the central tower, is this beacon the source of the Archmage's very vitality? You know what? Smash the beacon. That hurt me. If this is a vulnerability of the evil wizard, you must exploit it. You raise a sword to smash the blue gem. The creature leaps forward to stop you, but it is not fast enough. Your sword smashes through the glass. A moment later, the beam flickers, and the floor beneath you disappears with it, and you fall painfully to the broken earth below. I'm glad I only lost, I think, 2 points. You are back in the ruined tower. The wind howls through the broken structure above. Climb the stairs. You climb up the stairs again, but this time nothing changes. You reach the top where the stone falls away, and have no choice but to go back down. You step away from the ruin once more. Okay. Well, it makes sense. I think. We traveled through time to get to the top of the tower. And we were able to do so because the tower was collecting time. Now that it is no longer collecting time, we are simply stuck in the present. So whether we went to the future or the past, I'm guessing the past because the tower is whole, unless it was rebuilt. Yeah, we could no longer travel through it because it was deactivated, of course, so here we are. That was interesting. Hopefully that's given us an edge against the Archmage. You are back outside the tower. You can smell the troll's corpse, even from this distance. The path continues in both directions. Let's go down to the valley. Hope we don't trip and fall to our doom. You pass the tower and head down the slope into the valley. You scramble down the final steps of the valley slope. After a morning of dusty walking, you arrive at a cluster of trees, a sparse, spiny type that seemed to dot the area of High Zaman. It would be a quiet spot to rest. As the sun climbs the sky, the winds rise. I don't have a option to rest yet. I would. I could use a few points back. Hoping we'll find some a bush or a tree like this that might have fruit of some kind. For rations. Look around the valley. Oh, we have options. The valley continues straight ahead, dipping out of sight. To your right is a path leading up the far rock slope. The valley continues in both directions, and a track leads upwards. Alright. Let's head this way first, I guess, then, westwards. You continue along the valley. The middle of the day is hot. The grass here grows long and thick. Bits of rubble lie scattered amongst the greenery. The path leads away down the valley, following the line of a gathering stream, with a medium-sized lake visible just on the edge of sight. A pleasant, verdant stretch of land, the first you have seen out here. But there is no one living here, no one farming or setting up their home. Clearly the shadow of Manpeng is long and cruel. There is only one way to go from here, and that is back. Okay. I wanted to check out the pond and everything. You arrive back in the valley floor at the point where the path breaches upwards. Time to move on. You climb up the line of the ravine. You think you are still heading in the direction of Manpeng, but it's hard to tell so low down. I'm not heading in the direction of Manpeng, I'm down below. As you travel, the rock slopes begin to even out, becoming a valley peppered with clumps of grass and shrubs. The sun has reached its highest point now. Probably saw some kind of berries or more of that moss or something. You look around the rocks but come across nothing useful. Damn. The ravine. The ravine widens a little here. You clamber upwards as the grass underfoot gets rockier. Thin heat beats down from an empty sky. There's no time to waste. Well, what's going to happen? You walk along the heavy rocks and stones that line the bottom of the ravine. The sun is beginning to lower, and the air begins to cool. Search around. Looking around, you notice scattered amongst the rock a few rotten boots, dented breastplates, and other abandoned gear. Where did this come from? Keep digging around. After shifting a few rocks and pebbles, you discover the answer. The ravine is peppered with the smashed bones of adventurers who did not survive the fall from the bridges overhead. You are not the first to attempt the journey to Manpeng. Has anyone ever succeeded? Ravine walls. You go over to the walls of the ravine. They are worn and weathered, with several cracks and weathered pockmarks. You could try to climb, though the incline is sheer. Steep. Sheer. Steer. Huh. But you cannot stay here. You must find a way back up the slopes to continue your journey. I am looking for anything else that might be up this way first. You follow the path up the incline of the ravine, but it quickly becomes clear you will not be able to get out this way. The slopes on either side have become almost vertical. The sun begins to dip, heading toward the horizon. You pass under an arcing bridge. The walls pinch in on either side. This would be a good place to rest, but there's clearly no way forwards from here. The only way is back. Oh well, I was hoping we'd find something here. You walk along the heavy rocks and stones that line the bottom of the ravine. The wind picks up as the evening draws on. Soon it will be dark once more, but there is nowhere safe to rest here. Time to move on. You clamber down the rocks, and the grass begins to take over. The sun is sinking. Time to continue. Hey, again, notice it's rushing me along, huh? The ravine widens a little here. You follow the ravine downhill. The sun has almost set, and the sky has turned a deep purple. It'll be night soon. Can I rest in the tower? You arrive back on the valley floor, at the point where the path branches upwards. Time to move on. Going back. You climb the path, which soon steepens. You need to keep one hand on the rock wall to keep steady. It climbs, then sharply turns up the mountain. You keep climbing, vaulting boulders and grabbing tree roots. Up ahead, you make out the top of a stone tower. Another night begins. You should try to find a place to sleep, especially on an empty stomach. Hmm. So evidently we could have ended up down here another way and then made our way up. We could have fallen down here without dying. Possibly across the rope, where it's just somewhere around here, I don't know. The bridge. This big bridge we did fall away from and we did die. The bridge is no longer there anymore. So, yeah, we're towards the tower. You walk on, feeling your way through the darkness. You stand by the ruined tower once more. Sleep here. I lost stamina. Ah. Seriously? You bend down... Sorry, I'm reading ahead, guys. You bend down amongst the fallen stones on the outskirts of the tower. They will not give you shelter from rain or protect you from creatures, but they may offer a little comfort all the same. You have not yet eaten today, but you have no rations to ease your hunger. You find yourself beginning to scratch. You seem to have gotten fleas, probably from the monk's habit. Right, which cost us a stamina point. Close my eyes. You get comfortable and rest. The remainder of the night is restless with visions. Through it all, you feel the heat of Annalan burning should your quest fail. That sounds familiar, that we... from a past chapter. Something that we have not heard for a while. Sleep will not heal you if you have not eaten. I know. Ruined Tower. During the past day, you explore the ravines, disguise yourself as a monk, and began your ascent into the mountains. The Archmage is still waiting for you. Notice that it did not count me destroying the beacon as a milestone. You pick yourself to your feet and shake the dust from your tunic. The path continues in both directions. We will take this one. You climb up onto the cliff path. The early morning sun makes the air glow. The path splits here, shaking around the edge of the mountain, while a branch works its way downwards towards the stone tower. Which way now? Alright guys, we're heading back towards Manping. The trail winds through the mountains. You follow it until a sight ahead makes you stop. Higher up the rocky cliffs perches a strange creature made of twigs, branches, and moss. Look at it. It looks like a huge bird's nest perched on a wide stone ledge. If you were to climb the rock face up to it, you could easily fit inside. A huge bird's nest on a stone ledge made of twigs, branches, and moss. Climb up. I could put it for a vote here, guys, but I know you're going to say to climb up. You climb up, careful to hold on to your belongings as you scale the rock face. Then I lost more stamina. Outside the nest, you scramble up the rocks and hoist yourself onto the ledge just outside the enormous nest. Look around. The nest is an intricate construction of twigs and branches built into the natural cleft in the peak. It is about 20 times larger than the spikehawk neck nest you found on the High Zaman steps. On one side is a dark hole in the straw that might be large enough for you to crawl through. Can I strike a light? You bend down and spark a flame. A moment later, the flame has jumped to the dry straw of the nest. The delicate twigs begin to glow and curl. I didn't want to burn the nest. I thought it would be to look inside the dark hole. Let's try to cook my raw food. Ooh, 3 rations! Calmly and somewhat callously, you approach the edge of the flames. You unwrap the portions of raw meat and fish you have been carrying and roast them in the fire. The smell makes your empty belly groan and grumble. I think I should get down from here and eat it. Being we can eat it at any time from our inventory. Look at that. From 0 rations to 3. So I'm gonna save it. You save your provisions. They should keep well. Alright, guys, I'm gonna leave it here. Should I be kind and extinguish the flames? Should I wait and watch? But why? I guess for the bird to come and attack me. Hold on a second. Okay, my headphones cut out, so I want to make sure everything was still working. Yeah, should I extinguish the flames? Wait and watch for what might come, or quickly leave? I myself am leaning towards option one, or even more, probably three. It's probably too late. It's been cooking. They've been burning for quite a while. We did cook three portions of meat on them. So I'm leaning towards three. But let me know what you guys think. Extinguish the flames, wait and watch here, or leave quickly. Please post your comments, your votes in the, comments section below. Thanks so much for watching, thanks for voting, and always seek adventure. See you next week.